Screenplays are the foundation of nearly every narrative film.
Have you read the script?
And a screenplay's formatting is critical in ensuring all film departments are on the same page.
Can we just stick to the script, please?
In our previous episode, we laid out the fundamentals of script formatting. Today, we'll dig deeper into the nuances of what goes on the page and how. This is Anatomy of a Screenplay, Part 2. Before we begin, don't forget to subscribe to StudioBinder and click the bell to stay updated on all our filmmaking videos. For this episode, we'll use StudioBinder's screenwriting software to show the elements and industry standard script formatting in action. Let's get started. The screenplay stands apart from other literary art forms. It is technically a blueprint, not meant to be a finished piece of art by itself. As such, one of its primary functions is to provide a guide to filmmakers and their cast and crew. Screenwriting has many strict guidelines for formatting, but some more nuanced elements of a film don't have clear rules. Phone conversations.
Hi, Nikki.
Text messages, flashbacks, and more all require different approaches that vary from writer to writer. Therefore, some of the rules we will lay out aren't set in stone and can depend on the writer's intent.
Well, you can say that about most anything. It depends. Of course it depends.
Of course it depends. Of course it depends.
Mastering these nuances, however, can help a writer make full use of their medium. With that in mind, let's look at some script conventions for audio elements. Today, audio is just as important in a film as visuals. As such, how a screenwriter lays out different kinds of sound in a screenplay can be crucial. One common audio element is the phone conversation.
How'd you get inside my house?
You invited me. It is not my custom to go where I'm not wanted.
Different writers have different approaches to phone calls.
Have you checked the children?
What?
But at their core, they should be presented similarly to regular dialogue, with a character heading in uppercase, followed by their lines.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes?
Who is this?
The formatting can be relatively straightforward if you don't need to hear the other side of a phone conversation. In The Irishman, Steve Zalian adds a parenthetical that reads, into the phone, maintaining conventional formatting for the rest of the conversation.
Listen, I got that kid I was talking to you about here. I'm gonna put him on the phone and let you talk to him, okay?
Hello?
For the opening scene of The Matrix, neither characters on the phone are seen. So the Wachowskis simply mark the voices as VO for voiceover.
Yeah.
Is everything in place?
You weren't supposed to relieve me.
I know, but I felt like taking a shift.
Hi, Daddy.
Kim.
If the characters on both ends of the call need to be seen, a screenwriter may label the conversation as intercut. In Taken, writers Luc Besson and Robert Mark Kamen establish the individual locations the characters are in.
Gimme.
But then write intercut, where the scene heading should be. This makes the conversation more readable without constant scene changes.
Her cousins are back?
Oh my God, they got Amanda!
All right, listen to me.
Oh God!
Stay focused, Kimmy. You have to hold it together. How many people are there? Be precise.
Three, four, I don't know.
Where are you?
I'm in the bathroom.
Go to the next bedroom. Get under the bed.
Tell me when you're there.
Dialogue isn't always a clear back and forth. Sometimes characters are talking over each other.
Yeah, me too. Why don't you say it at the same time?
One, two, three.
I want a divorce.
If they are speaking largely at the same time, the characters' dialogue will be placed side by side. As this scene from Marriage Story shows.
Can I say something?
It was good. It's edgy. Directed by her husband, supposedly very controlling.
You know, we're lucky to have her.
I'm surprised she said yes.
We can thank her divorce.
But interruptions can be styled differently. For Fleabag, Phoebe Waller-Bridge uses a slash where the interruption should happen.
He says that
last night was incredible.
Which you think is an overstatement. But then he goes on to say that
it was particularly special because I've never managed to actually up the bum with anyone before.
Aaron Sorkin, meanwhile, uses two dashes to indicate someone is getting cut off. Here, no one is talking over anyone else's dialogue.
She's not cut out for litigation.
She's a hell of an investigator, Jerry.
And internal affairs, sure, she can crawl up a lawyer's ass with the best of them. But when it comes to trial work, I think...
I know. All passion, no street smarts. Bring her back in.
Dialogue formatting can also be affected by language.
Puis-je vous aider?
For Inglourious Basterds, Quentin Tarantino indicates language and subtitles in uppercase within his action. He notes when there should be subtitles and when there shouldn't be. But because he knows the people reading his script speak English, the dialogue is written so they can understand it.
Qui êtes-vous?
Je croyais n'être qu'un uniforme.
Vous n'êtes pas qu'un simple soldat allemand.
Ronald Harwood, meanwhile, gives a note at the beginning of The Pianist to establish how German should be presented. Sometimes a writer will want to include a music cue within their script. This might be as simple as mentioning the song name in the action. For Damien Chazelle's musical La La Land, songs are noted in bold within brackets. For audio elements, the primary consideration for a writer is clarity. The same could be said for describing graphics and text. Sometimes, a movie will require an audience to read words on the screen that aren't subtitles. Increasingly, filmmakers represent text exchanges between characters in different creative ways. As such, how a writer represents these exchanges can take many forms. They may write on the screen and describe the text, or depict the conversation in bolded action lines. For the most part, these approaches let the director decide how they want to represent the messages on screen. For The Bourne Identity, Tony Gilroy and William Blake Herron draw more attention to the text on a passport by aligning it to the right. This signals to the filmmaker that this text is important, so they should make sure the audience can read it. A multitude of approaches can be taken towards representing books on screen. A writer may note an important page as an insert shot. For Beau is Afraid, Ari Aster simply describes the nature of the writing and its contents in action lines. A common approach is including a voiceover of what has been written, as is famously done in The Shawshank Redemption.
Dear Red, if you're reading this, you've gotten out.
Computer screens are also a consideration for films taking place in a modern or futuristic world. The simplest approach to describing what's happening on a computer screen is through description in action. For Enemy of the State, David Marconi emphasizes important elements on the screen through centering and capitalization. Searching largely takes place on a computer screen. So writers Anish Jaganti and Sev Ohanian indicate the medium of each scene through parentheticals in the scene heading, such as webcam footage or desktop photo. Screenplay formatting can also be affected by unique plot devices. Not all films tell their stories linearly. Many movies, for example, contain flashbacks. Christopher Nolan's Memento is a prime example. In his script, he differentiates between the two timelines with italics. For individual flashbacks, he writes, "Insert flashback," followed by the scene heading. For a brief flashback, a writer may simply write, "Flashback," followed by the cutaway. But a flashback or flash forward doesn't have to be clearly marked. In Slumdog Millionaire, Simon Beaufoy doesn't label his time jumps. Instead, writing, "Seamlessly, we are back." Similarly, dream sequences can be marked in different ways. In Total Recall, the dream sequence is noted in the scene headings. In the BFG, it is noted in the action lines. It may not be labeled at all. In A Nightmare on Elm Street, Wes Craven omits any mention of a dream to trick the reader. Every so often, a writer may want to indicate a quick succession of shots. This can be introduced by simply writing "series of shots" in uppercase and listing them. For 127 hours, Danny Boyle and Simon Beaufoy lay out jump cuts in action lines. The signature quick cut style of Shaun of the Dead is represented through shots listed next to dialogue, allowing for the scene to read quickly and smoothly without excessive headings.
We take Pete's car, we drive over to Mum's, we go in, we take care of Philip.
I'm so sorry, Philip.
Then we grab Mum, we go over to Liz's place, pull up, have a cup of tea, and wait for all this to blow over.
Less conventional movie elements require less conventional formatting in a screenplay.
Open your mind.
Whatever approach you take, the priority should always be readability.
So I hope this will be readable.
Everyone should be able to understand what is happening on every page.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Start writing and breaking down your screenplay with StudioBinder's screenwriting software. And check out our Academy channel for full filmmaker interviews and in-depth tutorials on creating script breakdowns, call sheets, and more. Until next time, it's time for us to fade to black.